Okay. Good evening, friends. I'm very happy to meet you through this interaction on liver anatomy and physiology and share in our Facebook group, The Anesthetist. I am Dr. Surendranath, consultant anesthesiologist working at SIMS Hospital, Chennai. And my core work involves daycare anesthesia, GI surgery, trauma, urology, gynec, and orthopedics. And time to time, we have transplants, both liver and kidney, deceased donor, and live program is on. So I'm very happy to share my knowledge on this topic today. I would like to thank my beloved brother, Dr. Shivkumar Singh, for giving me this opportunity to share my knowledge on this topic with you. So I'm a great fan of this Tamil saint poet, Thiruvalluvar, who wrote a book called Thirukkural some 2000 years before, which has 1,333 verses, which doesn't contain itself for any country or gender or caste, creed, not even time, because the verses which the meaning which or the lessons which it gave 2000 years before is still valid in 2020. Today I'm particularly interested in this particular verse 399 in the chapter called Education. It goes in Tamil like this: Tamin buruvadu ulagin purakkandu kaam uruvar kattrarindar. That is, a person who learns feels happy and he reflects his happiness on everyone, that is by sharing his knowledge, which makes him long to learn more. So that is the feeling with which I approach you all today. In the process of sharing my knowledge, I reflect my happiness on you, and it makes me long to learn more and share with you more. So back to basics today. And this is very important in the present situation of COVID-19, that entire world is brought down to its knees and things are looking haywire here and there. Similar situation can occur in our clinical practice, which needs us to look back to our basics, and we need to dust our basic knowledge to manage the clinical situation. So this is more common in our practice and in day-to-day clinical relevance. The outline of this lecture will deal with anatomy and relevant functions of the liver. Initially, we'll start from the gross anatomy of liver and biliary system, go on the blood flow dynamics, and then deal with microscopic anatomy. Functions of liver will be broadly dealt in five classes, like metabolic functions, synthetic and detoxification functions of liver, immunologic and endocrine. Will just have a glimpse of this function, not much in detail. We'll have just a glimpse. I'd like to disclose that I have borrowed videos from YouTube for educational purpose only. Let us start with the case vignette, which happened some 12 to 13 years before in 2007. When a 45-year-old female was planned for a donor hepatectomy, that is the day when the live liver transplant started in my hospital. Then, as a trainee, I was involved in this case management, and she was planned for a live donor liver transplant. And I was told this right lobe of her liver will be pieced out and it will be transplanted into a recipient. So this was a huge or big surgery in our hospital. And as a second year postgraduate, I was in Sky, and I didn't know what I would expect the next day. But I was equally ignorant about what is going to happen and what are the anesthetic implications, surgical steps, what are the post-operative complications, how to manage. I was equally ignorant because I was relatively new to anesthesia as such, and more so for liver live liver donor transplantation. But I was told by my consultant and my friends that part of the liver and most probably the right lobe will be removed like this. It will be a clean cut made on the liver and the right lobe will be taken out. And within 6 to 10 weeks, the remaining liver in the donor will regenerate, as the liver will regenerate in the recipient. There will be an intraoperative cholangiogram done before the end of the surgery and to look for any biliary complications of the donor. And then we should expect for postoperative liver failure in donor. So these are the broad 4 or 5 points which was told to me in brief. And I was a bit, still I was ignorant about what is going to happen. So let us see the gross anatomy, liver being the second largest organ of the human body next to skin and the largest internal organ, weighing around 1 to 1.5 kilos, which is roughly around 2 to 2.5% body weight of an average adult. But it receives 20% of cardiac output. You can see that for a 2% body weight, 20% is the blood flow. That is almost like 10 times the weight blood flow is given to the liver. Broadly, liver is divided by a falciform ligament into left and right lobe. And this round ligament is a remnant of embryological organ or embryology, that is ligamentum venosum, which is remaining as a round ligament, which carries oxygenated blood from the placenta to the fetus. And you could see here inferior vena cava and a part of gallbladder. So this is from the anterior view. Inferiorly, you will see more details of the liver, where the most important or most significant one is the porta hepatis. The porta hepatis contain with it hepatic duct or the biliary system, hepatic portal vein, this is the venous system, which carries blood from GI organs to the liver, and hepatic artery, which brings oxygenated blood from the celiac plexus to the liver. And you could still see the left lobe and the right lobe. And you will also notice a caudate lobe, which is present here, and a quadrate lobe. So there are four lobes, basically right and left lobe, quadrate and caudate lobe. There are some barrier areas, and you could see the inferior vena cava and gallbladder in the gallbladder fossa. So there are some omental attachments which keeps the liver in its place. So if you see the liver from above, you will see the left lobe here and the right lobe here. The falciform ligament continues as a coronary ligament and attaches it to the undersurface of the diaphragm. Here, the inferior vena cava is joined by the hepatic vein before it drains into the right heart. And that's how it is more close to the right heart. So any pressure changes in the right heart will be reflected in the inferior vena cava and into the liver. So this is the gross anatomy of the liver. But what is more important to us is the liver segments. As an anesthesiologist and who was involved in the surgical care of the patient, liver segment is very important. And Cantley, Sir James Cantley, he gave a line which runs more lateral to the left lobe around here between the fourth segment and eighth and fifth segment, which divides liver on the basis of its vascular supply. So there is some watershed area which divides the liver into right and left lobes, but what we use is conoid classification of segments, which is based on the portal supply. So if you see from left to right on a clockwise direction, this is the lobe 2 and 3. The first segment is the caudate lobe, and the segment 2 and 3 will encompass the left lobe, which we see visually medial to the falciform ligament. And segment 4 will comprise the quadrate ligament, quadrate lobe, which is divided into segment 4A superiorly and segment 4B inferiorly. And the right lobe is divided into 5, 6, 7, 8 in a clockwise direction, okay, the boundaries will be mainly by the portal venous system. It is used for hepatic resection mainly to avoid any ischemia to the remaining segments which is left in the human body. So you have the right hepatic vein, middle hepatic vein, and left hepatic vein. So if you see this left hepatic vein runs between segments 2, 3, and 4. So medial to the left hepatic vein is superiorly the segment 2, inferiorly it is segment 3. And lateral to the left hepatic vein between middle and left hepatic vein is the segment 4. Superiorly is the segment 4A and inferiorly segment 4B. And lateral to the middle hepatic vein or between right and middle hepatic vein is segment 8 and 5, superiorly and inferiorly. And between right hepatic vein and the edge of the liver is segment 7 and 6, superiorly and inferiorly respectively, which has got a dedicated blood supply and biliary drainage. So this makes more relevant to us when we deal with any hepatic resections. And ultimately, all these hepatic veins, right, middle, and left hepatic vein, unite to form the hepatic vein, which drains into the inferior vena cava. The segment 1, that is which is a caudate lobe, has its own unique blood supply, which drains directly into the inferior vena cava. So this is what happened in the donor hepatectomy. They studied the hepatic venous anatomy. So the right, middle, and left hepatic vein. The surgeon is looking into the anatomy where he needs to divide the lobe. This is where the incision will run through, and they will take out this right part of the liver, that is the right lobe of the liver will be taken out. So they make a resection on that basis. The parenchyma is divided. They use a specialized instrument called CUSA, which runs a clear cut is made, which gives them a good plane without any bleeding or very less bleeding, because you need to get the correct segment. And you cannot have your own incision. It has to be dictated by the anatomy. So they ligate vessels on their way and divide the right lobe meticulously. So this gives them a bloodless field. And we need to maintain a low CVP to reduce bleeding from our side. So ultimately the right lobe is prepared. Last thing what they do is they loop the segment 5 and 8 vein, that is the intersegmental vein. And once they tie it, the right lobe will be ready to come out. So that's how the right hepatectomy was done that day. And you see a clear bed of the raw area of the liver, which is left without any bleeding. So this is what the anatomical background of the liver resection is. And it gives a very good bloodless field for the surgeon. And you can take out the liver without damaging the remaining part of the liver. The next anatomy, what we will look into is biliary system. Biliary system, it starts as a biliary canaliculi at the micros level of the liver. They form, they drain into big ducts, intersegmental ducts, and then form intersegmental ducts, or then it drains in lobar ducts to form right and left hepatic duct. And they form common hepatic duct, which will be joined by the cystic duct to form common bile duct. This common bile duct empty the bile into the second part of the duodenum by joining with pancreatic duct, the main pancreatic duct. So this will be controlled by the sphincter of Oddi, and there will be another accessory pancreatic duct which opens separately. There could be a lot of anatomical variation at this level, which can means the ducts can, these ducts can open individually, it can be together. There are a lot of anatomical normal variations. And gallbladder, which is supplied by the cystic artery, it's a branch of right hepatic artery. This is very important because whenever they do the right lobectomy, the cystic artery is ligated and they ligate the right hepatic artery and they do a cholecystectomy first. And then they go proceed with the right hepatectomy for donor. So this is the most important thing. And we have a lot of procedures, that is ERCP, where we give anesthesia for ERCP procedures to deal with patients with CBD stone, CBD biopsy, to place a stent for biliary stricture or pancreatic stent for pancreatic duct stricture. So they take a scope to the part of the second part of the duodenum. Through a wire, they reach the system and they can use a balloon or they can use a stent to dilate the stricture and to treat with the biliary stones. So CA head of pancreas leads to obstructive jaundice. So any growth here will impede the flow of the bile, that is mostly the conjugated bilirubin, which raises in the blood leading to jaundice. Cystic artery injury during lap cholecystectomy is one of the most dreaded complications which can lead to heavy bleeding. And CBD injury is more leads to more increased mortality and morbidity, mainly because of the biliary leak. If it is undetected, then it can, the mortality reaches up to 80 to 90%. Endoscopic ultrasound is a relatively new procedure where we can take biopsies from the head of pancreas. Suppose there is a patient with head of pancreas tumor. You can send an endoscopy ultrasound, endoscopic ultrasound machine, and we can pass a needle, take a biopsy. Celiac plexus block, which is used by a chronic pain physicians to relieve pain due to chronic pancreatitis and CA pancreas head by delivering 100% alcohol at the celiac plexus here. So these are the applied anatomy of this, gross anatomy of the biliary system. So a small video on endoscopic ultrasound.
The mouth into the stomach and the first part of the...
So they reach the second part, first and second part of the duodenum with the probe, having the ultrasound probe. They can image pancreas. One difference between imaging procedure is this, then means we can take biopsy from pancreas and we can have a definitive diagnosis. So they can pass needle. You can see here that they can pass needle under ultrasound guidance. They can take FNAC, which can be used to differentiate between benign and malignant lesions of pancreas. Next, we'll talk about blood supply. The most important thing in liver is it's a very good child, because if you are a good son or daughter, you will get pocket money from both your parents, isn't it? Both your mom and dad will treat you with good pocket money and you can spend it judiciously. So liver is a very good organ. So God has given dual blood supply, one from hepatic artery and another portal vein. This is the portal vein, mainly because it is formed by superior mesenteric vein and the splenic vein. And this hepatic artery and portal vein divides into right and left branches respectively. Along with it, you see the common bile duct dividing into right and left bile duct. This blood supply reaches the hepatocyte, getting metabolized in the hepatocytes. The blood drains into hepatic veins, namely the left, middle, and right hepatic vein, to ultimately drain the inferior vena cava. So this is the gross anatomy on the blood supply of the liver. So if you see the detail of the blood supply of liver, the hepatic artery is a direct branch from the celiac artery in 80% of people. In 20%, it can directly come from aorta. So this carries around 20 to 25% of the liver's blood supply. And the remaining blood from the celiac artery goes to the stomach and other GI organs and ultimately drains through the portal vein into the liver. So whatever be the splenic circulation through celiac artery, superior mesenteric artery, and inferior mesenteric artery drains through the portal vein. So 75% of the liver's blood supply is through portal vein. So if you see the ratio between the portal vein and the hepatic artery, it is 2.5:1 ratio through which the blood is given to liver. And hepatic artery brings oxygenated blood. Portal vein brings deoxygenated blood, but it brings all nutrition from small intestine, colon, and it brings enzyme-rich fluid from pancreas through the portal vein to get and to kickstart the metabolism in liver. Ultimately, this blood drains through the hepatic veins into the inferior vena cava. So we saw hepatic artery brings oxygen-rich blood, portal vein brings nutrient-rich blood, and hepatic vein drains the oxygen-poor blood into the inferior vena cava. So the blood supply to the liver is around 20 to 25% of the cardiac output, which is roughly around 1,500 ml, and big reservoir of blood, and it can be used in time of hypovolemia. Any splanchnic circulation or splanchnic vasoconstriction can shift the blood from the reservoir into systemic circulation. And we saw that hepatic artery supplies 25% of the blood supply to the liver, but it brings 50% of the oxygenation because the PaO2 is very high in comparison to portal vein. It brings 75% of the supply, but it which equals the hepatic artery in oxygenation. In normal patient, the PaO2 or the saturation, oxygen saturation is 85% in the portal vein, but during fed state, that is after food, the saturation drops to 75% in the portal vein because the GI is active, GI system is active. So there is a difference between the blood, the saturation of the blood in the portal vein between fasted and non-fasted state. There's something called hepatic artery buffer response. This is very important because this ensures that liver gets relatively constant blood supply throughout. It maintains a constant blood supply by modifying hepatic artery blood flow. There is an inverse relationship between hepatic artery and portal vein. That is, if the portal vein blood flow reduces, the hepatic artery dilates and reduces its resistance and increases the blood flow. But if the portal vein increases in the blood flow, the hepatic artery goes for vasoconstriction and reduces the blood flow. So there is a relationship between portal vein and hepatic artery blood flow, but inverse is not true. That is, if the hepatic artery blood flow reduces, portal vein cannot buffer for the loss of blood supply to liver because of decrease in the hepatic artery blood flow. So there is a inverse relationship between portal vein and the hepatic artery blood flow. So what are the proposed mechanism? Something called adenosine washout hypothesis. Adenosine is produced from the smooth muscles and tissues locally. So if you increase the blood flow in the portal vein, what happens is it will wash away these adenosine, and adenosine has got some vasodilatory properties. So that will lead to hepatic artery vasoconstriction and hence increase the resistance and reduce the blood flow. But if you have a decreased blood flow in the portal vein, the adenosine level increases, which will increase the which will reduce the hepatic artery resistance and increase the hepatic artery blood flow. So this is the basic mechanism of hepatic artery buffer response. So what happens in well-fed state? That is, can liver increase the oxygen demand supply through this buffer response? So postprandial state, the oxygen demand is fulfilled by increased oxygen extraction. Maybe not by buffer response, but it increases the oxygen supply by increasing the oxygen extraction. So this is a word about hepatic artery buffer response. So there are various receptors on the hepatic artery, that is alpha 1, alpha 2, and beta 2. In the portal venous system and the splanchnic veins, predominantly it is alpha 1 and alpha 2. And in hepatic veins, it is alpha 1, alpha 2, and beta 2. So the sympathetic catecholamines are produced in the adrenal gland, which will interact with this receptors, and it may modify the blood flow. So what is the effect of this system on hepatic blood flow? That is, if there is an increased alpha 1 activity, it causes hepatic artery constriction and decreases the blood flow. And at the same time, if you increase the beta 2 activity, it causes decrease in the hepatic artery resistance and increases the blood flow. Suppose if you use, for example, if you use alpha agonist, pure alpha agonist like phenylephrine, what does it do on the hepatic artery blood flow is it reduces the blood flow by vasoconstriction. But at the same time, if you use beta 2 agonist like isoproteinol, that increases the blood flow by vasodilation of the hepatic artery. But what happens in hypovolemic situation? We all know that during hypovolemia, this splanchnic blood flow is reduced and it shifts the reservoir. The reservoir is squeezed into systemic circulation. How does it act? The endogenous sympathetic activity during hypovolemia due to any bleeding or something like that, the sympathetic response kicks up and it secretes epinephrine or norepinephrine from adrenal medulla. That reaches the hepatic artery and splanchnic veins. Epinephrine will be acting on the alpha 1 and it squeezes the blood into the systemic circulation. Because the effect of alpha 1 on the portal vein, mainly as a capacitance vessel, when it squeezes the portal vein, around 200 to 400 ml of blood will be shifted to the systemic circulation. At the same time, alpha 1 activation of the hepatic artery reduces the blood flow to the liver. But once again in hepatic veins, the alpha 1 activation squeezes the blood into the inferior vena cava. But if you use adrenaline or noradrenaline to treat the patient exogenously, it depends on the state of sympathetic response shown by the person already. Because the blood in the reservoir is already emptied, it may not be of much benefit to use exogenous adrenaline, noradrenaline in such situation, and it will lead to GI ischemia and lead to multi-organ failure. So in that situation, we need to use blood and blood products early, because you have already exhausted the system, the reservoir, which has already diffused around 1 to 1.2 liters of blood into systemic circulation. Yes, your exogenous epinephrine or noradrenaline, may increase the systemic blood pressure and maintain blood flow or blood pressure in the heart and the brain. But as far as the liver is concerned, it is all squeezed, which will lead to ischemia of the GI system. So what is the clinical relevance of the liver blood flow? That is, there are very many factors which alters the blood flow intraoperatively. Spontaneous breathing during inspiration, the negative pressure created sucks more blood and increases the venous preload. And during expiration, this is there is an impediment in the preload because of the positive pressure. What happens during positive pressure ventilation under anesthesia? Both during inspiration and expiration, there is reduction in the most importantly, volatile anesthetics. What happens is it reduces the systemic vascular systemic pressure and it decreases the hepatic artery blood flow, and it ultimately reduces the hepatic artery blood flow from the liver. Sorry, hepatic venous. We just saw the effect of vasopressors. And hyperapnea will increase the blood flow, and hyperapnea will reduce the blood to the regional anesthesia. By the sympathetic blockade, it reduces the systemic vascular resistance and reduces the blood flow to the liver. Most importantly is the surgical factor. Retraction packing of the liver significantly reduces the blood flow to the liver together. So that is more important than any other thing. So what about portosystemic shunts? So what is portosystemic shunt? There is a shunt between portal system and the systemic veins. Okay, there is some venous anastomosis, which are usually quiet. They don't disturb us, but except whenever there is an increased portal pressure or portal hypertension, opens up and the blood leaks to the systemic system. And they present as hematemesis, caput medusa, or hemorrhoids, or even ascites. What are the common sites of this portosystemic shunt? At the lower esophageal, gastroesophageal junction, from the left gastric veins and the lower esophageal veins. This is the most important reason for hematemesis. The next is the portal systemic shunt, portosystemic shunt between superior and middle rectal veins and the inferior rectal vein, which can present as hemorrhoids. The next one is, at the umbilicus, between the periumbilical vein and the superior and inferior epigastric vein, presenting as caput medusa. And in the abdominal wall, the collateral veins can lead to ascites formation. And in the veins of Sapi, under surface of the diaphragm, can lead to bare area bleeding under the under surface of the diaphragm sometimes. So these are the five region or regions where you can see portosystemic shunts. Why this is very important is whenever there is a portal blood shunted to the systemic circulation, this takes a lot of toxins instead of reaching the liver and directly reaches the systemic circulation. And that leads to presentation as hepatic encephalopathy because the culprit is ammonia. So we'll see a case vignette. This happened some 2 weeks before. A 44 years old male had three episodes of hematemesis. And he presented to us at 10 p.m. after his dinner. So emergency esophageal banding was planned. Though he had three episodes of hematemesis, his hemodynamics were stable. So rapid sequence induction with endotracheal intubation was done, which was a very short procedure lasting from 5 to 10 minutes. And medical gastroenterologist, before taking the scope out of the stomach, gave a complete wash in the stomach and emptied the stomach completely. So this is how it happened. So you could see the lower end of the esophagus. There's some active bleeding going on. And with the scope, he could suck the bleeding varices into it and deliver a rubber band over it and stop the bleeding. Once he's convinced with a proper banding, he takes the scope out. It doesn't go inside and doesn't disturb this again. So this is the emergency esophageal banding, which we will be involved many times because as an anesthetist, you have to take care of the GI bleed as such. So the most important applied anatomy is variceal bleed. Patients can come for urgent or emergent esophageal banding or sclerotherapy. Portal hypertension, which may present to us as ascites. Shunt surgery, splenorenal shunt surgery is very common to relieve the portal hypertension is carried out to divert the blood from splenic vein into the renal vein like this. They ligate the renal splenic vein and shunt it with the left renal vein most commonly. And this is to reduce the portal pressure. And another most important aspect is when you introduce Ryle's tube or when you place a probe for TEE in liver cirrhosis patient, it should be done very gently because you can precipitate a variceal bleed, which you do not intend to. So this was a picture about a splenorenal shunt. So next is the microscopic anatomy of the liver. There are multiple functions which was done by liver, by a group of cells, by many groups of cells. Most importantly, parenchymal cell and non-parenchymal cell. The most important cell is hepatocyte, which constitutes around 60 to 80% of the liver mass and around 90% of the liver weight. And this is the most important cell because it can regenerate. This is the cell which regenerates. And the other type of cells are non-parenchymal cells, mainly the endothelial cells, which is fenestrated, and it has got a low pressure blood flow system. And the next important cell is a hepatic stellate cell or ITO cells, which store fat and vitamin A, but they are very quiet. They are very good friends of yours, but if you irritate them, then they become very nasty cell and they cause a lot of fibrosis and lead to cirrhosis. Kupffer cell, they are macrophagic cells. 80 to 90% of the macrophage cell of the body is placed in the liver, and it is involved in the phagocytic activity, because a lot of endotoxin bacteria are absorbed from the GI system, and this is the first gate. The Kupffer cell is the first gate, and it has a lot of innate and adaptive immunity through T and B lymphocytes also. Dendritic cell is again an antigen presenting cell, and the other one is a cholangiocyte, that is bile duct cells. So if you take the microscopic anatomy, there are two things, that is anatomic unit, that is the classic lobule, and a functional unit called a sinus. The hepatocyte is a polygonal cell which has got six sides, and at each edge or each corner you will see a portal system, that is a branch from the aorta as hepatic artery, arteriole, and from the digestive system through the portal vein, it leads to the portal venous branch and a biliary duct or hepatic duct. The blood from this will pass through the sinusoids or the fenestrated endothelium, and it will reach the central vein. This is the central vein, and blood will flow from central vein through the hepatic veins, drain into inferior vena cava. But the bile which is formed goes in the opposite direction from the central vein to the biliary duct or hepatic duct and reaches the biliary system. So it happens, the blood flow is opposite to the biliary flow. That's what we need to remember. This is the anatomical unit that is known as classic lobule. Six sides, and each corner has got the portal triad, and center is the central vein. So this is a classic hepatic lobule, and we saw the blood flow is from the portal hepatis or the portal system to the central vein, and the biliary flow is from the central vein to the portal system. The functional unit is known as a sinus. The center of the a sinus is formed by the portal tract and the periphery by the central vein. And the hepatocytes which fall in the center form the zone 1, which is highly oxygenated. It is fed with highly oxygenated blood, and this is also known as periportal zone. Zone around the central vein is known as zone 3, and that is known as perivenous zone. Okay, and the zone between 1 and 2 is intermediate zone or zone 2. So you could see here clearly the portal tract giving a branch of hepatic arteriole and the portal venule, and the bile duct drains the bile. If you see here in the zone 1, this receives the oxygen rich blood and nutrient rich blood. And from here, the oxygen tension reduces. Once it reaches zone 3, it has got the least oxygen, and perivenous zone or zone 3 receives the deoxygenated blood. And this is more prone to any ischemic events. So perivenous zone or zone 3 is more prone to ischemic events. What is a sinus? We'll see in detail. The zone 1, that is periportal zone, which receives the oxygenated blood. The most important activity which requires ATP or oxygen, oxidative metabolisms like gluconeogenesis or ketogenesis, beta oxidation or protein synthesis happens in this region. And this is the region which regenerates first whenever the hepatocyte regenerates. Next is the intermediate zone. And third one is the centrilobular zone or perivenous zone or zone 3, which receives deoxygenated blood and is more prone to ischemic insult. There's a high incidence or presence of cytochrome P450 enzyme system, and it is involved in drug detoxification here. And anaerobic metabolism like glycolysis or gluconeogenesis, which generates ATP and carbon dioxide, happens here. And ischemic injury is very common. And aerobic metabolism happens in zone 1. This is a flow mechanics. The portal venous blood and the hepatic arterial blood flows through the sinusoids, reaching this hepatic venule. Before it reaches the hepatic venule, the nutrients and the oxygen is delivered through this fenestrated endothelial cells into the hepatocytes. And the bile, which is formed from the hepatocyte, flows away from the central venous system into the biliary tract. If you see the oxygen tension at porta hepatis is 60 to 65, and it keeps on reducing towards the hepatic venule, and it reaches 30 to 35. So a word about hepatocyte. We all, it is a 60% of the cell mass and 80 to 90% of the cell volume, polygonal shape. It is highly regenerative cell and carries out all metabolic, synthetic, and detoxification function of the liver. It has got three surface types. That is one, this is a basolateral surface, which is the surface area is increased by this villi-like structures. So it exposes itself to more nutrients and more oxygen. The next surface is the apical surface, that is, it forms at the biliary canaliculi. So if you see in an hepatocyte, one surface has different function than the other, because here you have to just throw the bile into the biliary canaliculi. But here we need to absorb nutrients, and here there is going to be an excretion. And the third surface is adjacent to the hepatocyte. Lot of organelles, hepatocyte organelles, which is involved in protein synthesis, that is rough endoplasmic reticulum. Drug biotransformation is by the smooth endoplasmic reticulum. Beta oxidation occurs in peroxisomes, and ATP synthesis by mitochondria. Hepatocyte has got hundreds of mitochondria because it needs to synthesize ATPs. And it metabolizes or deaminates the catecholamine here in the mitochondria. So it is a very, very important organelle. Golgi apparatus synthesizes albumin. Lysosome leads to autolysis of the cell. Microtubule secretes bile. So these are the various functions done by hepatocyte. The next important cell is a hepatic stellate cell or rhytocells. They are very quiet. They store only fat and vitamin A or fat-dependent vitamins. So they are very quiet naturally or normally. But if there is any cytokines which irritates them, then it becomes a nasty cell and it transforms itself into collagen-secreting myofibroblast. So it stays in the space of DC between the fenestrated endothelial cells and the hepatocyte. And it is most important cell in promoting wound healing and scar formation. So once it secretes a lot of fibrotic cells, and fibrosis occurs, then it reduces the blood flow through the sinusoid, and it increases the pressure in the sinusoid, and it leads to cirrhosis and portal hypertension. So that's how the stellate cells are very important to us. The next important cell is a endothelial cell. If you see the lot of fenestration in the endothelial cell, which improves the nutrition and the oxygen exchange with the blood, sinusoidal capillaries and the hepatocyte. And the regulation is mainly because of the endothelial presence of nitric oxide synthase, which synthesizes nitric oxide, which is a potent vasodilator, and it vasodilates and increases the blood flow. In cirrhosis, what happens is this endothelial cells are damaged and the nitric oxide is not secreted, leads to vasoconstriction. But the splanchnic nitric oxide increases and leads to splanchnic hyperemia. That is the most important feature for cirrhosis, and that is the basis of forward flow theory. And it forms the ascites. The next important cell is Kupffer cells. They are macrophages in the liver. A huge load of toxin, endotoxin, and the bacteria reaches liver because that is the first gate from the GI system, which gets absorbed from the GI system. So somebody has to stop this endotoxins and bacteria reaching the systemic circulation. So Kupffer cell takes that role, and they are non-specific. They can phagocytize any cell, and uptake of toxin is very high. And 80% of the body macrophages are in the livers in the form of Kupffer cells. And they have the intrinsic and innate host immunity properties, and they are very non-specific in dealing with microorganisms. Next is, what is the functions of liver? We'll come to the physiology of the liver, the most important being metabolic. Carbohydrate metabolism. Usually the glucose is stored in the liver as glycogen. Roughly around 100 grams of glycogen is stored in the liver to help us during crisis. That is, if somebody fasts or during the fasting stage, this glycogen is broken down into glucose through glycogenolysis, and energy is supplied to the body. Insulin and glucagon secreted from the pancreas reach the liver quickly, and it kicks the carbohydrate metabolism. Almost 50% of the insulin is deactivated in the liver as first pass metabolism. We'll see about it later. And glycolysis happens in zone 3, as we saw before, and it produces a lot of ATPs and energy. Gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis occur in zone 1. They are all aerobic metabolism. They require a lot of oxygen presence, and it is done in the zone 1. Lipid metabolism. So either lipids which are absorbed are either used for produce energy, or they are converted to form triglycerides. So beta oxidation produces a lot of acetyl-CoA and ketone bodies in zone 1, and 80% of the cholesterol is secreted in bile, and the rest is transported to body by LDL to form cell membranes. So protein metabolism, they involve in both catabolic and anabolic functions of protein. It synthesizes albumin at around 120 to 300 milligram per kg per day. And they form a lot of clotting proteins and a lot of important carrier proteins like beta-2 globulin are synthesized in the liver. The albumin has a half-life of 21 days, and it determines the plasma oncotic pressure. So the liver also makes globulin complement protein, CRP and haptoglobulin. So they bring amino acids to gluconeogenesis to form, to produce energy or glucose. And the amino acids are broken down to form urea. The intermediate product is ammonia. Ammonia cannot be excreted through kidney. So they form urea, which is more water soluble, and they get excreted in the kidney. The amino acids, either they undergo transamination, deamination, or carboxylation, and the end product being ammonia. And urea, which is more blood soluble, gets excreted in the urine, as you all know, and 30 grams of urea is produced from 100 grams of protein. So what is the clinical implication? As we all know that during portal hypertension, there is portosystemic shunts which open up. And the end products of protein like keto acids and ammonia, they reach the systemic circulation without being converted to urea, which usually gets converted in zone 1. Because the liver functions are reduced and there is a shunt from portal system to systemic circulation, this ammonia reaches the systemic circulation and leads to a lot of trouble with brain. And the ammonia is usually converted into glutamine. And this glutamine is, they are non-toxic, and the conversion happens in zone 3. So the ammonia glutamine hypothesis in encephalopathy is that the ammonia reaches blood and it is neurotoxic, leads to cerebral edema. It causes both cytotoxic cerebral edema and vasogenic cerebral edema. That is the most common cause for hepatic encephalopathy. The next metabolic function is bioproduction. It is formed from cholesterol. It produces folic acid and quinodeoxycholic acid. They get conjugated with taurine and glycine and become water soluble as bile salts. They are what become water soluble bile salts in the gallbladder. So whenever a fat rich diet reaches the duodenum, the gallbladder contracts and delivers this bile salts into the duodenum. These bile salts, before getting conjugated, they are very toxic to the hepatocytes. So hence, the conjugation with glycine and taurine renders this bile salts water soluble and non-toxic. The bile salts in the gut gets converted into quinolic acid, folic acid, and lithocholic acid. The main function is to esterify the dietary fat. And once it esterifies the fat, it gets absorbed into the small intestine. Okay. And it also helps in absorption of vitamin A, D, and E and K, which are fat soluble vitamins. 90 to 95% of the bile salt, when it reaches the ileum, they get reabsorbed and gets circulated as enterohepatic circulation because it again reaches the liver and gets secreted. So this is known as enterohepatic circulation. The bile also has got some excretory function for toxins and drugs which are metabolized in the liver gets excreted through bile. Next is bilirubin metabolism, that is the hemoproteins, and 80 to 90% of the hemoproteins is from hemoglobin or heme, which from hemoglobin and myoglobin and cytochrome P450 enzymes. In the spleen, the heme from the hemoglobin is converted into biliverdin and then conjugate it is converted into bilirubin as an unconjugated fraction. This is not soluble, so it gets albumin bound and gets transported to liver, where in the presence of UDP glucuronyl transferase, it gets conjugated with glucuronyl moiety and becomes conjugated bilirubin. This is your direct component of the bilirubin, and this is the indirect component of the bilirubin. This conjugated bilirubin gets secreted in the bile and then undergoes the enterohepatic circulation. Once the bile reaches once it reaches into the gut, the bilirubin is converted into urobilin with the help of the bacteria present in the gut, and some part goes into the as stercobilin and gives a typical color to the fecal matter. Urobilinogen gets converted into urobilin and gets secreted in the urine and gives its standard color. The most important pathology here is porphyrias, acute intermittent porphyrias, where it can be present in one of the system, one of the enzyme deficiency in the heme process can lead to porphyrias. And whenever they expose them, these patients to barbiturates, they come into crisis. So the applied anatomy of this biliary system is most important being jaundice. That is increased bile secretion and leads to yellow urine. We saw that obstructive jaundice because of CA pancreas can lead to increased unconjugated bilirubin and leading to pale stools and itching, mainly because of bile salt accumulation. And something called bile loop syndrome, which can happen in GI surgery, where this part of ileum is altered. It has got an altered bacterial growth and leads to steatorrhea, vitamin B12 deficiency, and fat-soluble vitamin deficiency. And post-cholecystectomy, because the bile which is stored in this gallbladder is not concentrated, and the biliary bile acids reaches directly the small bowel, that can lead to post-cholecystectomy diarrhea, which is usually self-limiting. So what is the clinical relevance? So if you have a patient of jaundice, you can have bilirubin urine, or you may not have bilirubin in urine. If you have bilirubin in urine, it is mostly conjugated bilirubin, and it may be because of genetic defects in excretion, Dubin-Jones syndrome or Rotar syndrome, or it could be hepatobiliary disease like hepatitis, where it releases the conjugated bilirubin. In jaundice with no bilirubin in urine, it is mostly unconjugated bilirubin by overproductions through hemolytic anemia, or it could be impaired conjugation in congenital conditions like Crigler-Najjar syndrome or Gilbert syndrome can lead to increase in the unconjugated bilirubin. So these are two types, that is unconjugated bilirubin, mainly because of hemolytic anemia, Gilbert syndrome and Crigler-Najjar syndrome, and increase in conjugated bilirubin in Dubin-Johnson syndrome and Rota syndrome or hepatitis. The next important thing is drug metabolism. The most important thing is bioavailability. If you give a drug in an IV route, the bioavailability is almost 100%. But if you give in oral route, the bioavailability depends on the liver metabolism. It may be low or high. If the drug absorbed from the GI system reaching the liver, it has got increased metabolism, then the bioavailability of that drug will be very low. That is, the serum concentration of that drug will be low. You need more dosing, or you may increase the dosage. But if the same drug undergoes less metabolism in the liver, the bioavailability is very high and it may lead to toxic levels. And it is also dependent on co-ingestions, because the fluctuation of the metabolism depends on co-ingestions also. So there are three phases of reaction, that is divided one phase one reaction, phase two reaction, and phase three reaction. Phase one reaction. Drug makes it more polar by three metabolites. It leads to physiologically active metabolites, some of which can get excreted through bile or through the blood by a kidney, but most of them it needs to get processed by phase two reaction for excretion. Here, another polar group is added and leads to conjugation. This is known as phase two reaction. So the metabolite from the phase one reaction is attached with a polar molecule, either a glucuronic acid, acetic acid, or sulfate group, which is added to the metabolite and rendering it more water soluble. So it can be excreted either bile or urine. The phase three reaction is a misnomer actually, because it is not a metabolic phase. It is nothing but ATP dependent excretion via some transporters from hepatocyte into biliary canaliculi. So something called ATP binding cassettes, ABC transporters, they get attached to the biliary canaliculi and they transport the waste metabolites into the biliary system. So this is phase three reaction. So if you see in a nutshell, once the drug reaches the liver, it undergoes phase one reaction with the help of cytochrome P450 system. This is the most predominant system, oxidation, reduction, or hydrolysis. You have other system like monoamine oxidase or alcohol dehydrogenase, which can also be classified as phase one reactions, which converts the drug into active metabolite. Some of the active metabolite can get excreted, and this can have more toxic effects. So it requires phase reaction for conjugation. So they get conjugated with glucuronic acid or acetylic acid, or they undergo sulfation reaction to render the metabolite more inactive and more water soluble, get excreted into bile through the biliary canaliculi, or it will be secreted back into the sinusoid, into the blood, which can be excreted through the kidney. Sometimes may bypass this phase one reaction and can reach the phase two and become a substrate for phase two reaction directly. There are some enzyme inducers or enzyme inhibitors. This enzyme, cytochrome P450 enzyme, they have polymorphic expression. So there are a lot of genetic variation. And with that, if some drugs can induce the system or use the enzyme and increase the drug metabolism. Drugs like phenytoin, carbamazepine, barbiturates, especially phenobarbitone, rifampicin, alcohol, and smoking can induce the enzyme. So suppose if you give a patient with OCP, OCP can get metabolized, because if the same patient receives carbamazepine, for her epileptic disease, then there won't be any protection for pregnancy. So there would not be any clinical effect of OCPs. At the same time, there are some enzyme inhibitors like omeprazole, allopurinol, disulfiram, erythromycin, valproate, isoniazid, cimetidine, binge alcohol intake or sulfamide. This inhibits enzyme P450 and it can increase the bioavailability of the drug. Suppose a patient who is on warfarin is also given omeprazole, and if this drug interacts with warfarin by inhibiting the enzyme, the warfarin effect increases and INR may be more prolonged in a patient. So we have to remember these drug interaction through enzyme inhibition or inducers. So what are the clinical implications of drug metabolism is, as an anesthetist, we should know about halothane hepatitis. There are two types. Type 1 is more mild and there's a transient increase in transaminases and usually self-limited. This halothane gets metabolized with the help of cytochrome P450 in zone 3, and the active metabolite is trifluoroacetic acid or TFA. Go pathway, and this leads to free radical and it damages the hepatocytes and leading to hepatic damage. The type 2 is more, it is associated with more mortality, around 50%, and the basis is autoimmune. It is mainly autoimmune based. The trifluoroacetic acetic acid metabolites, they bind to hepatocyte and they form a metabolite, hepatocyte haptin. And this is presented to the immune system that produces a lot of antibodies. So if the patient comes to the next exposure, this antibody reaction can lead to centrilobular necrosis and fulminant liver failure. So whenever we use codeine and it is dependent on cytochrome P450 system for its metabolism, codeine is nothing but it has got a methyl group instead of hydroxyl group in third carbon atom and the molecule of morphine. So 10% of codeine is converted into morphine, which has got some analgesic effect. Suppose if the patient has got some genetic variation of this cytochrome P450, there could be variable clinical effect. And if the drug gets more converted into morphine, there will be more analgesic effect. Or if less drug of the codeine gets getting converted into morphine, there will be less analgesic effect. To us, is another important drug is clopidogrel and PPI interaction. They compete for the same enzyme, and this can reduce the clopidogrel effect and leading to instant thrombosis. Cyclosporin and erythromycin, if it is used as prokinetic, that can increase cyclosporin toxicity. Another most important drug which we use in our clinical practice is paracetamol or acetaminophen. The toxic dose is 150 mg per liter at 4 hours after ingestion. It leads to deficiency of glutathione. So once the glutathione is deficient, there is increased accumulation of N-acetyl benzoquinone amine, which is an unconjugated metabolite. And this is very toxic to hepatocytes and it leads to zone 3 necrosis. So it is treated with the help of N-acetylcysteine, which is a precursor of glutathione, and it donates the glutathione group, and it is used in the treatment of acetaminophen toxicity. Liver and coagulation, it produces all coagulants, anticoagulants, fibrinolytic and antifibrinolytic factors. The most important coagulation factors are 1, 2, 5, and 7 to 13 are produced in the liver. The von Willebrand factor and factor 8, apart from the liver, it is also produced from the endothelial cells. The anticoagulants like antithrombin 3, protein C and S, and plasminogen are also produced in the liver. So the balance between anticoagulants and the coagulation factors will render the patient at risk to bleeding or risk of thrombosis in a liver patient. The clinical, the bedside or the laboratory test which we do, mainly PT-PTT, they reflect the degree of the procoagulant effect on a liver disease, but they do not check the antifibrinolytic arm of the coagulation. So we do not know how well the anticoagulant antifibrinolytic limb or the fibrinolytic limb of the coagulation acting in the liver patient. Liver, as we saw, it is a main organ for immunity, for both innate and adaptive immunity through Kupffer cells and dendritic presentation, dendritic cells where they present the antigen to the T and B lymphocytes. They have innate immunity, which is more non-specific. And it is very important because the natural killer cells, which are present in the liver, they can alter and they can accommodate the tumor and plays an important role in tumor biology. The adaptive cell immunity with specific T and B lymphocyte targeting the antigens can be present in the liver. And last thing is endocrine function. Many hormones are produced in the liver, like thrombopoietin, which is important in production of platelets, angiotensinogen, which is a precursor for angiotensin, and insulin-like growth factor, which is ultimate of growth hormone, which growth hormone exerts effects as IGF-1, and many steroids are produced, steroidal hormones are produced with the help of cholesterol from here, and suppose you have androgens, which the steroids, the cholesterol produced in the liver gets transported and become estrogen or progesterone or aldosterone. It activates many hormones like vitamin D. The initial hydroxylation happens in the liver and then it gets transported to kidney for 125 cholecalciferol. Thyroid hormone activation, that is from T4 to T3, happens in the liver. It inactivates many hormones, that is like insulin, inactivates approximately 50% of the insulin through first pass metabolism, and it inactivates aldosterone, estrogen, and ADH. So friends, as a take home message, liver is the most important organ with multiple functions, which has got a dual blood supply. This is the only organ in our body which can regenerate, and the multiple functions makes the liver disease as a multi-system involvement. The anatomy is manipulated for a surgical benefit to render us a bloodless field, and we can take a lobe of liver and transplant it to another lost much earlier than any other function of the liver. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Thank you very much, sir.
Oh, that was wonderful. One, you can switch off the sharing screen now, Suren. I think long lecture for people, but I'm sure they would have enjoyed it. So if you quickly unshare that, and then we can, yeah. So yeah, I think it went very well.
I think I have done some justice to the...
you done very well. You've done great justice to the topic. I think, like I said, it can be quite a boring didactic lecture, but I think including clinical, sides to it with your few cases and some of the videos, I think has made it interesting. I think people actually just ignore because it's such a boring area, but such an important organ in the body. So I think people need to actually know. There obviously, a lot of clinical implications of how you manage a patient for hepatectomy or for liver transplant. That probably we can discuss some other time lecture. Like you were talking about, like for example, when you're doing a hepatectomy, why you need to actually keep CVP low, how you keep it dry, and its implications later on. And then so many factors are produced in the liver, coagulation factors, how coagulation can be deranged if something goes wrong during intraoperatively. Okay, so how do you monitor coagulation intraoperatively for these patients? And I think the other thing is also like when they're doing liver transplant, there's such an amount of blood shift, volume shift. Okay, so there are a lot of factors. I think there's a lot of learning goes in when you're actually doing a case of liver surgery or hepatectomy. I think we can discuss that later on. I've got, I think, a few interesting actually cases because one of our surgeons used to do a massive resections for tumors,
mm-hmm.
and how these patients actually present, how you manage their analgesia, how you manage their fluids, intraoperatively different, postoperatively it's different. So it's a very, very interesting topic if we actually look at it. Okay. So we'll see you soon.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Okay. See you. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye.